a lot of fun here.
Yeah, because it is. Yeah, people come from below this thing. Let us see, guys. It's a great talk. All right. Here we go. Oh, you see?
Yeah. Star Trek. Okay, so what's this?
Star Wars? Some people. No, I can't work. One. does for a living, right? Java goes to Stack Overflow and answers questions about Java and Java 8 and Java 3.
Which is cool, like meaning that the guy essentially
is generally like that.
Yeah.
Okay, he's a cool guy. So thanks to him.
Absolutely.
Okay, now let's talk about rules, since none of you are familiar with the original partners. We'll lay out some rules on how this stuff works. So join the many guys on stage. That will be us. Right? Funny puzzling questions. I will promise you there are puzzling. We hope they are funny as well. You think you hope. Now this is a very, very important point right here. This talk is only fun if you participate. Now I guarantee you that you won't know at least 90% of answers. And after first or second questions, you're like, I give up. Fuck this shit, I don't know it. But please keep voting. It's only 4 questions, so it's 25% chance of you guessing right. And it even happens that you guess right twice in a row, person sitting next to you will think that you are very, very smart. Right? So you basically have nothing to lose. Yeah. So just keep voting. Okay? Now, for we have official Twitter handles, Java Puzzlers NG, like Starlet NG, and of course Codemash. And a lot of the explanations, the resources, the reasoning behind the puzzlers, the slides, and the video will be published right here. Right, so if you want to see this.
It's kind of meta. So we'll say this on video, that this video will be published on this
here,
site where they find
right.
The
so when you watch the video and you see this in the video, don't go there because you are already there.
Yeah.
You don't need to go there already.
Exactly.
Okay?
Yeah.
All right. What else? Yeah. Okay. So no cheating. This already. Yeah.
Okay.
Do that.
No googling. No IDs. No.
The funny thing about
no
puzzlers is that they are funny.
If you try to
solve
it in your mind.
Yeah.
If
cheating.
You try to solve it in
one.
Yep.
And we do it for a while, so a lot of them are online already. You could find them, but please don't. Right?
Yeah, because there's no point that you lose one. So this is basically expression that you might see on the faces of your colleagues, your people see that.
And we will see it on your faces.
Obviously, yeah. So this is the
now
we're
just getting time until it runs on. Okay, right. Now it's okay.
Yeah.
All right, so everything works to the Java, to the latest Java update, or it doesn't work, but at least it behaves as expected.
Yep.
And with that, are you ready?
Yeah. Are you ready?
Yeah.
All right. So first one.
Okay. So first one, I'll do all the things that you don't remember. So you know,
I do.
You do?
Yes. Of course.
Okay.
You said you
right. All right. So broken eggs then. And here's a very simple control in crypto.
Okay.
So we just build a grocery list. We add stuff to this, like new bread sausages, and then we convert it to Java 8 string.
Okay.
And then we want to add something because we forgot something. Adds! Don't forget the adds! And then we actually execute for each Pringle.
Do you have any options for like answers that
new bread sausage.
Okay.
It's too late to add the adds.
Uh-huh.
Meal bread sausage, don't forget the X. We added it after we converted it to string, and everything still works. Meal bread sausage concurrent notification exception. It's too late and it fails. Or concurrent notification exception.
So, the stream, I know this, that stream is kind of lazy data structure. So, the calculation or any type of processing will happen only when some so-called like terminal operation will be called. So I think, I don't see how it's puzzler because it's pretty much, it's used. And I'm pretty sure that nothing's gonna happen here. So I think, people can avoid.
Okay, so now it's your turn. Who thinks X will just be ignored and nothing will happen?
Okay,
right.
We have one person.
Thank you very much, we appreciate it. Who thinks that, as Victor said, it's not a puzzle, everything is going to work and and we just waste your time here.
Yeah.
Okay, here you go, a lot of bugs.
Okay.
No, people trust you and John.
Well, sir.
Which both of them sound like a very bad decision to
make. Not trust down into it.
How about Neil Bratzos concurrent application exception, right? That makes sense as well. And just concurrent application exception, that's right. And guys, you are good. Thank you for voting. The correct answer, as puzzling as that may seem, is B. It actually worked.
Yeah.
And I will give people a t-shirt, but you spoiled it because you gave the answer.
Okay, I explain. Okay, that's okay. So basically, I already explained this. So we do have new data structure, not data structures, new construct, like a syntactical construct, an API, that allows you to do processing of the data as sort of like stream of data. And the stream API allows you to stack different information, and they will be executed only once the terminal operation will reach, for example, or some other, like, collect or something else. So if you do construct like this, nothing's going to happen. So in this case, it's quite normal, and
it just works
as expected.
But we are not here to see stuff that works as expected.
Okay.
So we will add a twist on it. We will go back.
Okay.
Right. We have exactly the same code, but before we convert the stream, we remove the sausages.
Mm-hmm.
And then we do everything again.
Okay.
So what say you?
Yep.
Meal break sausage,
yep.
X sausage will be added in X1. Meal break, X don't forget the X. Meal break with the notification exception, and with the notification exception.
So I get, this contradicts with everything. It doesn't contradict everything what I said, right? So there's no like terminal operation that happens here, so I think it's going to be still going to be. So everything's going to be fine.
Of course.
In some list,
So who thinks, who will for option A? Both sausage will be in it, and the X won't be added. Now this answer by now shouldn't make any sense in any possible way. Good. How about B? Everything still works as expected, and you just don't have any better place to be now. How about C? Now it fails with concurrent application exception. And how about D? Just concurrent application exception. Yep, that's a lot of points for persistence.
Exactly.
There you go.
Who's exciting for us, you know, Nice, that's super cool.
You got these on show, right?
Yeah.
Nice.
They shooting right now.
Nice.
And I guess people will be better for.
Oh, yeah, they will.
Alright. So in this particular case, I have a distributor service. I have a bunch of files, and I'm reading the contents of these files in the server file. And by doing submitting this task into executor service, and I'm sending this number. And basically, the file contains something similar in terms of punish or not punish. So what's going to happen?
Okay, so I'll tell you what I see. First of all, those are two lambda expressions, right? The one is without the curly braces and without the semicolon, the other is them. And I see here that we use this file write method, which takes two parameters. One is where to write, and that will be path get to provide the path to where to write. And the other is the string, which is punish in this case. And then we submit it into an executor service. Now, I'll tell you what I see is that we have here very, very strange syntax. You have a semicolon inside an expression. And I think this is just wrong. You can wrap it in the curly braces, but semicolon should be needed. So I vote for one compiles, two does not compile.
Okay, so it's time to cast your voice. Who thinks it's an A as a bar thing? Who thinks it's
yes.
A because of this guy? No, it's A, right?
Yeah.
Who thinks it's B? Who thinks it's B?
Okay, here we go. How about
roll
for fun?
Roll for fun?
Yeah, that's fine. How about both?
One compile.
One compile. Here you go. Just for fun. Thank you very much, sir.
So I think when you see these kind of things, there's some groovy defaults inside.
Oh yes, absolutely. That's way too much semicolons for a groovy guy like me.
Okay, so let's.
Look at that.
Yeah, even though I think he was right in terms of groovy.
Who knows this guy? Ian LaForge, the lead of the Groovy Language Project. We don't like semicolons too much. Well, now to be serious for a second, anyone has any idea, especially you since you wrote it, why one compiles and two does not? No. Anyone? Now when you know the correct answer?
Guys, I will just teach some of the nice stuff that we have here. So if you know the right answer, you will get a very nice t-shirt. It's very good.
Go ahead, sir.
So go ahead.
No, it's not a bug. We're officially done, no more bugs. Yes?
What?
inline C, right? We don't have those curly braces, and that means that we can only put one expression here, and it will become the body of the number, right? Now, since it's not a real method, we can only put one expression, we don't know, we don't need the semicolons, and we don't need the return method. What this method will return? Whatever this expression, the single expression, which is there, returns, right? Now, I will make guesses whether the file.write returns a value. What do you say?
Yeah.
It returns a value. Which value it returns? Boolean? Almost as ridiculous, but maybe even more.
Here you go.
It's an integer, the number of characters written, right? So what we have here is the first expression is a lambda that returns an integer. The second expression is a lambda that returns void. Now, what do we know about method submit in executions? How many are they? No, I mean definitions of the method submit in the class executor service. Not that many.
Yeah, essentially.
Is it one for each?
No.
Which one?
Two. There are two.
So who knows, like, who using this executor service in real life? You guys using this one? Or you still like starting new thread dot run whatever?
There are Java 1.4.
New thread dot start.
Interpreter on Java 1.4.
Alright.
Okay.
So essentially, the method submit accepts runnable or callable. What's the difference between runnable and callable?
In terms of the interfaces. How they are defined?
For what?
For the callable.
Good,
okay.
Good, thank
and,
you very much.
And?
Callable returns a value. How about the runnable? Wait, we'll get to what you want to ask.
Yeah.
Runnable does not. Good. So now we're getting even closer. Now we have two lambdas. Each of them fit different signature. This one fits callable. This one fits runnable. So far, so good, it should compile. They will call different overloading of submit method. This will call the one that returns callable. This one will return runnable. Now, what is the other significant difference between callable and runnable? Why callable was added in Java 5? Returning the type
and
No, there is one very obvious reason. What was the main problem of runnable? If you ever wrote runnable, you hit
it.
Into it.
You can't stop it.
No, that's a threat.
No generics?
No.
Maybe is callable?
No. Check exceptions.
Runnable
does not declare a check exception. That means that if inside the run method of runnable, you write any code that throws a check exception, you have to put try and catch inside the run method, and the problem is, except of being ugly and verbose, what the hell should you do in your catch? Right?
As usual, we throw and let...
No, you can't, because... Oh, you can throw a runtime exception.
Exactly, yeah.
You can catch check exception and throw a runtime exception right in this check exception.
Exactly.
That's Java 2 for you guys,
right?
So callable defines throwing exception, okay? Now getting back to our two executions of submit. Is there any chance that code that uses the class file and uses the class path does not throw a checked exception? No way at all.
Who knows which kind of exception?
Oh, that's simple. Who knows?
IO
exception. Obviously, IO exception. I guess like five IO exceptions out of this line of code, at least, right? This still works fine because it's callable, it matches the return type, and the exception that is thrown here, rethrown by callable interface all the way outside of this map. This one won't compile because it throws checked exception and it's not taken care of.
Wait a second, you just said it won't compile?
Yes, the 7 won't compile. We know already one compiles, two does not.
Two does not, okay.
Right? So we know that it fits the runnable interface. And we know that this goes inside the run method. But it does not catch exception, so it won't compile. That was a good puzzle. So here is all the explanation that you said. Right? Explicit return, runnable, callable, right? And then we know that this guy draws exception, this does not, this returns the value, this does not, all the things.
Next time you should use the slide.
I enjoyed the conversation much more. It was fun. All right. Now, MedMax, classic or modern? Classic?
Classic.
Classic, right, classic. You're right, in Java too. That's fun. All right.
Now for you.
That's the one I like. So here we go. Try not to give this puzzle away as you usually do.
Okay.
So system on println, we have a stream of a lot of numbers, and then we call a max method providing a reference to an end of max. And run a get. What will be that? Compilation error, random exception, 3, or something else?
I'll go with something else.
Nah, you're boring.
I don't see, like, we have stream, we call the max method, method reference, and I'm just, you know, okay, so let's do runtime exception for...
Runtime exception is a good choice, solid choice.
Yeah, but, you know, just for the sake of, but it's still picking something.
All right, okay. So who thinks it won't compile? Probably because you cannot do that. Yeah, sure, right, thank you. How about runtime exception? That's a solid choice, just because Java can always have some runtime exception. Now, how about it just works and does what it's supposed to do? As you already saw, that might happen in this presentation. Nice. How about something else? That's a good choice, isn't it? It is. Of course, it is something else. Now let's try it again.
Let's see. What else?
-3, -1, 0, something else.
How
far down does this garbage mile go?
I'll go with something else.
Sounds good, especially considering that all the other choices do not make any sense at all. How about -3? Any takers on -3? No. How about -1? All right, 2 hands for -1. How about 0? Sure. Any takers on something else once again? Well, I'll do it, I think, 10 p.m. We can do it like tomorrow.
And it's pretty sad that if someone else will come after this show in the floor,
we can rerun it and do something else like in the. It is -1, by the way, ladies and gentlemen. And I have 2 takers on that one that for sure are ready to explain why. Aren't they? You want to see a code once again?
Sure. Can I throw out an attempt?
Yes.
So max gets the max value of 3, but then get is getting the 3rd value of the string.
No. Nice, but no. Okay. It would be very groovy puzzle, by the way. By its style, but it's Java, it doesn't do this get of number.
That would have got
zero. You need to do a 2 complement.
0, that
should get 0.
You need to do a 2 complement band?
No, it's easier than that.
So, basically, I think.
Okay.
Because many people maybe still programming
because
Java 2.
Because double is unsigned.
No.
You're doing that.
Yeah, no, that's a tough one. Let's just go with that.
Yeah.
What you need to remember here is one thing. Java, with Java 8, became a little bit less strongly typed than it used to be. an integer. Now we suggest, we expect a certain behavior, a contract from a comparator, that if we give two numbers and one is bigger than the other, we return one. If they are the same, we return zero. If the second is bigger than the first, we return minus one. It's a contract, but it's not written anywhere. The only written contract is two integers in, one integer out. Right? Now, let's consider a static method max in the utility class map. How does this method work? What it receives?
Who knows?
Two integers. What it returns? It returns an integer. The signature looks exactly the same. Right? The contract is completely different. Max takes two numbers and returns the bigger of them. Comparator returns two numbers and returns minus one, zero, or one. But the signature is exactly the same. And when Java infers the interface of this lambda, it says, look, it looks like comparator. Fine with me. And now, let's have some fun. So, max between minus 3 and 2 is minus 2, which is less than 0, and that gives the max method order to select minus 2, because minus 2 is bigger than minus 3. Now, minus 2 and minus 1, the max will be minus 1. It's still smaller than 0, which Java will interpret as keep minus 1. And now, minus 1 and 0, the max is 0. For the max method that expects a result from comparator, 0 means they are the same. And we can keep minus 1. Because they are the same, there is no reason to replace. Minus 1 and 1, biggest is 1. Bigger than 0, that means that 1, that we need to keep the number that is there. And so forth and so forth, and minus 1 will always stay.
So I think here, like, takeaway from this puzzle is that even though compiler trying to do very smart things by including particular type from interface, you need to make sure that you're putting right things in right places in terms of semantics of the methods. So this is why, even though from compiler time the contract looks same, like one out, two in, they semantically might be doing something else.
So guys, beware the less strongly typing of Java and Java.
You stay on that one?
You have the slides right here.
So how would you fix this then?
You just implement a comparator here.
So instead of this method, you just simply either pass the lambda, that will just
the comparator.
That's it.
Or you can use a static class, utility class, that's called comparators. And in this utility class, you have a method which called max. And this max is a comparator max and not a two numbers
class. So basically, like, utilities class is like similar to max. So you can do comparators max.
And comparators max solve the problem, right?
Okay, it's my favorite.
Yeah, okay, go ahead.
All right, so we're going to talk about how to upgrade your Java 2 to Node.js and very fun stuff. So we have two maps. One map represents some old school technologies, like we have a built to Maven, Java, and DB2. DB2, anyone? DB2?
Yeah,
no,
very shy one, like, but yeah, I saw
it. DB2 is cool. They still can, you can do like queries on something somewhere.
Okay, this guy got it with DB Talks.
Alright. So, and there's a user set, like NPM as a build tool, JavaScript is a language of choice, JavaScript. But it's like a Java, but, you know, simpler. Yeah, simpler. And so the database will take the license from it, right? And I want to replace.
Right.
I want to replace.
You want to replace the old school with proper. Sounds good.
Yeah. So how do you think what's going to happen here?
All right. Those are the answers. This guy won't compile.
Okay. Who thinks it's map will be switching?
Okay. Thank you.
One gentleman. They both become old school.
So it will be like the other way around. Instead of replacing for the new one,
they all will become hipsterish.
Which is the intended, what do we want to achieve?
Well, yeah. And fix the one compile.
Yeah, here we go. People know the map interface.
Right? Yeah, all right. Okay. So, but actually, answer is hey.
And I'll just
yeah.
Watch.
Yeah, it's a perfect, perfect view. Just okay. Let me explain this. So, Barm mentioned absolutely right that replace all. Actually, no, it doesn't receive the method. So replace all its new method that arrived in Java 8 that received by the function. So this is a special type of functional interface that will receive the so-called by function. So now I'll explain why. And if you ever use math, you probably, on very rare cases, think, what the hell is this? Why?
Anyone, okay, now let's be honest. Who knew that method put returns a value?
Just the odd value.
Exactly.
Look at that!
Exactly. Yes, exactly.
Good job, guys. Well
so
done.
The way how the by function works, can you switch your... So the way by function works, it takes two values and basically returns, in our case, we'll take method put. Method put will return value as a previous result, and it will fill previous map. In my case, it was old school. It will fill it with result of method put, which returns the previous value. So this kind of like good construction. But basically, this interface request call can be expressed in the old school way. So the by function will apply a new value, which was old value from the previous map, into the new map. So this is why this thing will work, and this is very good and very concise way how you can swap this map or screw someone on the interview. So if you ask, how one can substitute two maps.
Classic interview question, how do you switch between two maps?
Without third map.
That's a completely new, wicked, and very, very weird way to switch between two maps.
Yep.
Crazy stuff.
Yeah, this is very, very
stuff. Right, so this put thing, if put were to return void, it wouldn't work.
Yep.
It wouldn't work because the by function expects a return time. One parameter in.
Pretty much the same idea that we showed on the previous one, where you have two parameters in, one parameter out, but with different constraints that we have in other maps. Okay.
Yeah, so in other maps, because what it does here, it returns a value that we'll get in the old school map, and it will be the proper map, and it will put it back in the new one. So they actually switch.
They actually switch again.
That's crazy.
Yeah, you can show this code once again. So one more. So you have, so you take the key, which is key of the new map, and you will replace each key of new map with key from old map. And after that, like subsequently, it will happen with the old map. And plus, it's because in Java collections, they're mutable, so this kind of stuff is kind of, it's possible, but we need to, live with it.
Right. Okay, so I'm on max script, so here is another max for you. Well, so first of all, who gets the reference?
Just a moment. Can you go back one more?
Yes. I like that.
I'm trying to wrap my head around it, and I'm trying to figure out, you've got one. one map with a value, you've got another map with a different value. If you set one to the other, you're going to overwrite the value. So how does it do that without using temporary storage or holding that?
So essentially, there is temporary storage. Each and every time when you call put, it returns previous value. Because the keys of these maps are the same, it will simply replace all value with two
value. Map and you get up the old value and then you turn around and put it back.
Yeah, so in this case, then okay. your temporal storage.
So you have temporary storage.
Temporal storage is you basically the result of the
metadata. It's in the stack.
Yeah,
right.
this guy. Yeah.
But I was just trying to figure out where it was. And he's right, it's in the stack.
Yeah.
As a friend of ours once said, everything is stored in the memory. It's somewhere in the memory, that's for sure.
It's just hard to follow.
All right. Yeah, no, it's a complicated one, but it was so fun. Okay, now who gets the reference for the kiddies swarm working for?
Or some TV show.
That's
a good guess here.
The Big Bang.
Dr. Sheldon Cooper, theory. Alright. Okay, so Victor, I have a list.
Yep.
And I have a comparator.
Uh-huh.
Which is a natural order comparator.
Okay.
Right? That's the comparator class we spoke earlier about, right? Natural order, which means in our case it will go by the alphabet.
Yep.
I wrap it with nulls last, just to make sure that if there are any null in this list, the null will be last.
Okay.
Right? And now I print, I max it in three different ways. First is the good old max method in the collections interface. Been with us in Java 2, solid stuff, I provide the list, and I provide the comparator.
Okay.
The other is taking the streams out of this list, and then iterating through it with the collect method and comparing the list with the collector's max by method, providing the comparator and the get in the end. And the third way is getting the stream and then instead of all that, just calling it max method, providing the comparator to it, and then of course get on the stream.
Mm-hmm.
So far so good?
Yeah.
How many lines will be the same? All the lines are the same. Two lines are the same. All lines are different. Or four lines are different.
I don't see how it's even possible. I think the whole lines would be the same. So we do like the same stuff, we just, you know,
different. Who thinks that it will work as expected? One.
Absolutely not.
Absolutely not. That's good. Now, B option, statistically, is the one to vote. Right?
Yeah.
And here we go, rational people on the ground. How about all different? Right? Anyone thinks that?
I'm going crazy right now.
Here you go. Yes.
People
are living on the edge. They didn't have it like that.
Okay.
Good job, guys. Well, it's all lines the same.
Yeah.
And now you should go, as Victor is. Where's the password?
Yeah, how is it in the password, right?
Right?
How it's in there?
Okay.
Okay, that's cool. Okay.
I take the same code and throw a null into it.
Yeah.
Right.
Always nice to throw some nulls.
It's Java. Can I bring without nulls?
Yeah.
Well, we have some protection right here. I already wrapped this comparator with the null class, which, you know, explains to Java what to do with nulls. And now this code is the same, and the answers are the same.
Mm-hmm.
So how about now?
I still think it's all lines will be the same.
Of course,
because it just, you know, null would be, you know.
And we'll get poor soft null.
Yep.
Make sense?
Yeah.
Who thinks poor soft null three times? Okay, right, yeah, looks good. How about two lines the same? The statistically solid choice? So without null, when everything works,
okay.
It's the same for everybody.
Okay.
We throw null in, and everything screwed up in tons of individuals.
Okay, let's see what kind of explanation.
Okay, so let's start with the easy one.
Yeah.
Collections.max, been with us forever since Java 2, what will be the answer? I only do it in max. What would be the max? Which means the last.
No,
of course not. Poor, soft, and now last. It's all good.
Yeah.
Now how about this guy? Strings, nulls, optionals. Monads, now it bird becomes interesting.
Exactly. Who knows what kind of method, what kind of like result that it collects, what we do in get all that. Anyone?
What this guy returns, on what invoke the get? There is a new class. Almost. There is a new class that invented to pretend to prevent null pointer exceptions. It's called optional, right? Good stuff. It should prevent null pointer exceptions. It does. We won't get null pointer exception. Instead, we will get no such element exception.
So, let me introduce you to your new friend.
The class optional, and namely, it's method get. You will love it. It's great.
So, first time it was null, now it gets no such element exception. We're going.
And?
And continue.
And here is another one. Now, this guy also calls get on optional, which kinda gives us the hope that it will at least fail in the same way, but it won't even get there. And that's because method max will throw null pointer exception because it encounters null.
So null will come from
null last puts the null last. Great. Max throws null pointer exception if the maximum element is null. So we won't even get to our cozy and familiar no such element exception, as we would expect, since we know our optional too good, because we will get null pointer exception earlier. So we will get null in the first case, no such element exception, and null pointer exception. Isn't Java 8 fun? It is.
Consistency all the way.
Oh, you want me to do
it?
Yeah, you're good with it?
Yeah, of course.
All right.
So, story about mutants. You remember when you start your like object-oriented programming,
yeah.
And they teach you about different constructs and how your brains, for example, they say, okay, you might have interface that will define some behavior, like a barkable or flyable or something like that, right? So we will try to do similar, but in very, very weird.
So since we are after dark and we are literally unlimited with time, I will take this and I will be trying.
Yeah.
I will take this opportunity to tell you a story about my first Java teacher.
Okay.
So my second Java teacher was the best teacher in the world. Like, he told me everything I know. The first one, we had one class with him. And he started by trying to explain us the object-oriented concept, and the example that he gave was a horse. And he was about the stuff that, you know, horse do. It can drink, it can eat, it can run, and someone asked, and from the audience, and we were a bunch of trolls, when it dies, is it still a horse? And he's like, well, I guess, yes, and if we cremate it. He quit after this lesson, and then I got my best teacher in the world. So yeah, let's do mutants.
All right, so in the mutants, we have two interfaces, and these interfaces, they do have default methods. So for those of you who haven't heard heard about Java 8. So in Java 8, now there is the ability to create default methods, which defines a default implementation of this method. So we have interface cat, which has default method, and does map. And dog, which has method bark, and makes blocks. Now, we need to do something to merge these two behaviors
into a dog cat.
Or pet dog.
Dog cat.
Okay, so we have here. And now, we want you, or I want you, and maybe the audience will help you to provide the right construct for implementing this kind of functionality.
Okay, a couple of things that you'll need to know. Def won't work in Java, right? But the thing is, the idea is, what should be written here? And what can we cast to so this code will work? We cannot cast it to Dogcat because Dogcat is a local class inside a method. So the question is, what can we put here and here in order for it to work?
Fair enough. Okay, so the second, third, do we have four?
Yeah. Of course. The fourth so is a right one.
The first one, we just use ampersand operator and we do intersection all the types. We use this construction that also uses intersection. So there is new meaning of operator ampersand in Java 8 that allows us to do intersection of the types. Or we do something like this.
Okay. Yeah.
And
then,
of course,
the D is a very solid choice for you right now. Okay, so the real question is, on which circumstances I can use the intersection of types operator? Can I just pass to it like nothing happened? Maybe I can use it, but only as a generic type. Or maybe I can use it only as a casting to a lambda type. Those are the three options.
Returning type of lambda.
Right. Returning type of what lambda returns, basically, right? Or, of course, the right answer. So I vote for D.
Okay.
There is no such thing that you can do here that it works.
Now you will be told about the create course. Maybe you can translate this faster into this like. Sorry. Okay, so who thinks it's A?
Yeah, so that's one of the questions. Is it valid? If any of that is a valid syntax.
What I'm trying to say here, in Java 8, there is another meaning for ampersand operator. So it actually can be used as the type intersection. But
Or can it?
Okay, in this case, you need to choose like what's the right or valid way how you do, or where you can use it. All right, so who thinks it's A?
You can just cast to an intersection of two types like there is no tomorrow.
Yeah.
There is tomorrow, obviously. Nobody wants to do that.
We need space.
That's okay. Like it's PowerPoint trees.
Okay. No one, right? So
yeah,
where do you guys start?
I'll tell you what, they are all waiting to what D. I know.
Okay, so D, anyone?
No, some data from B.
Because
D is
implied. It's like weird because every time like people see like the generics and the question marks, it's kind of or T's. The people simply go off as a version.
Extends.
Yeah, exactly. So who thinks it's C? Okay. Who thinks it's D?
Right. So D is implied with other options as well.
Okay.
But maybe someone thinks that D is standalone. Well, so the answer is C. Right.
Who might attempt to explain?
Yeah, no, there is not much to explain, and I think that Bill Gates does the best job to explain how it works. Well, you remember we spoke about that lambdas became much less, with lambdas, Java became much less strongly typed.
compiler behaves a little differently how it behaved before, and
this is one of those, right? So there is a lambda that inside might have inner classes, like we had in our out method, and it will create an object, and it will return this object. Now, the final thing about implicit returns is that we don't specify types. If we don't specify types, we can get away without specifying this private type. Now, it's completely up to us.
Which one? Yeah, so the people will see.
Yeah, exactly, right? So here, we can actually define a DOM class, a cat class, and return the intersection, the DOM cat.
So the thing is, you need to explain the way how it works from perspective of optional. What the method of will expect.
Right. So the method of explains accepts a type. Right. It will be optional of this type
of something.
Which, if you remember the fun with optionals, means it will verify that it's not null. Right. For the sake of our code, it doesn't really matter. We could use any other method that receives the lambda that returns type.
Optional.
It's just our favorite, of course.
No, it actually returns optional, it's also returns
right.
Optional. So this why this type will be passed.
It is a class.
It's a class of object to to like union of thought.
Exactly. Now this class is completely optional, right? Because this object is an implicit return, right? This is like the concise syntax. Now, let's say inside here we define this docket class of ours, right here, inside this expression. Can we do it? We can. And then we can return.
Yeah.
Can we do it? We can. And then we can skip the return type. Can we do it? We can. Will it work? Yes. Now, if it works without the cast, it has to work with the cast as well. And that's why this cast is allowed.
Yeah.
Does it make sense? Not so much. Welcome to Java.
So essentially, it will be able to, compiler will be able to, because compiler really doesn't care about generics and then types and then this.
Well, it does.
It does, this lookup will be doing like, how it's called, dynamic.
Yeah, that's involved in.
Yeah.
Well, but it doesn't really matter, right? Whatever is written here, it's not a method, just to show you that it has both of the methods, right? This if present stuff. And here, the only real interesting part is with implicit return, you can skip the cast. If you can skip the cast, you can do crazy stuff. And that means that it should be supported with the cast as well.
So you're saying that you don't need the dog
exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right. It's implicit return. It's exactly what we have with code. Right? And the compiler will figure out the type. And if it turns out to be an intersection type, it will be an intersection type. Now, if it's already an intersection type, we can cast for it. Yes?
So what happens if the default method is the same? So what if,
then you will have to implement them as they were abstract methods. That's how Java protects from dynamic problem in multiple inheritance.
I think we have puzzle for this one.
I don't think so.
No, not this one.
No, we don't.
That would break multiple inheritance.
Right, so, exactly. So, since we now effectively have multiple inheritance, the protection against the diamond problem is that if the methods collide, they are, consider them not having any implementation. You will have to implement them in the code. That's how we protect it.
But yeah, that's kind of weird stuff.
That's what you feel now about Java 8, and we feel good.
That's kind of this kind of weird stuff that
you don't like good stuff.
Can you turn back a little bit?
Oh, come on.
What is one reason why we come up with this? No, one more. Back. Back.
Not that?
No. I like it. So the reason why we dealing with this stuff is because you're doing this inline crazy thing. Right,
but you can do it inside your lambda, and that's the exact thing.
But do not do this in your production code, because people who are gonna support this gonna kill you, or at least they won't be
chat, not an email, not a fax, not a written letter, you need to call. And
it's in the fax.
No. From the place that I am, you cannot send a fax. And that's the 21st century. okay, so now the problem is, of course, both the combination of heavy accent and a funny name drives people crazy. So this is how we call it. Me and people. So we start with hello, like, can you hear me? And they're like, what? And then we decided we need to shout. How do we shout in code?
Lowercase. We're using caps.
Right? So we take it to uppercase, and now let's make a copy of the same thing just for the sake of the program. And then we decide even that didn't work. We need to go back to natural alphabet in order to spell it by the letter. H is a model, E is an echo, L is a lima, L is a lima, O is an Oscar. Right? And now we print the two lines. So my question is, what will we print? Both caps. All of them caps because we uppercased it. But both natal alphabet, hello, and then natal, natal, and then hello. Or hello, hello.
It does look like very similar to me, so I'll take.
Yeah, we switch here from hello to hotel in Oscar, and the question is what happens.
Okay, so I think it's going to be okay. No, not really. I think everything will be.
Because they're lazy, right?
It will replace it, and that's going to be hotel, echo, legal, in Oscar.
Both. You want for one. I don't think the switch that we somewhere in the middle switched from letters to numbers?
No, I'll take two.
Well, take two. All right.
Two. So I think, because we have this one, yeah, I think two.
All right, now he has no idea.
Two.
Yeah. All right. So who thinks both of them will be the NATO alphabet combination? All right. How about two? What Victor said. How about three? The other way around. The first one will be replaced. This one. The second won't be replaced. This one. This one is
too much.
Again. Who thinks it's two? Good. Who thinks it's three? Good. Who thinks it's four?
You want to
string is. String is final, just a hint. String is final. Four. String is final. No? No? All right. The correct answer is two. Who knew?
Yeah.
This is us, by the way. Every time.
By the way, I just guessed this, I guess.
No, you have no idea. Anyone like smart people? Yeah.
So, in the definition, when you actually call git, and therefore it's going to be the
the uppercase of whatever ECR is here.
So basically, welcome to JavaScript world. Pretty much.
Nah.
Pretty much like
it's not that bad.
It's pretty much like
welcome to lambda world.
Yeah.
Yes.
Poisson, like a Poisson in JavaScript.
Yeah, leg binding, deferred invocation, all this fun stuff, right?
Nice.
Yeah. So actually, look at this side. This side makes it very easy to see, right? Because what we have here is actually a supplier that will be invoked the get method, and this is a content of an anonymous inner class that implements the supplier interface, and this is the content of its get method. This is what it is, actually, right? If we remove syntactic sugar from lambdas, we end up with object. It's Java. There is no like magic in it. Still, yeah.
But I think with this gentleman is right. If we will use an anonymous
class, yeah.
So in this case, we need to make final. So in this case,
Right. So we already solved it.
Heavy artillery.
Yeah.
After
an hour. After an hour and 10 minutes already.
All right, our favorite characters teamed up like three times on the big screen, so it's I guess it's what's the time that we have the puzzle?
That's I think this. We have like in every season of the puzzles we have.
Yeah, because we love such a.
Yeah, and because we can do endless jokes about Chuck Norris, and one of them is gone.
Okay. So basically, in the Java 8, we have a method point that allows to do an iteration.
It's
for
strings.
Yeah. So the for each except the method that will do something. So but we kind of like want to do some nasty stuff and want to remove.
Wait a second. Who knows that you shouldn't modify a collection under iteration? Everybody know that. Almost, and now together, which exception that we'll get? One, two, concurrent modification exception. Yay, good. So what we are trying to do here is forcibly get a concurrent modification exception. Right?
Yep.
Good. I know. It's like I wrote it.
Yep. Okay. I think it's because of chart numbers. Everything is good.
Yeah, so you cannot really remove chart numbers.
Yeah. No exceptions. It's all good.
Doesn't make any sense. If you try to remove chart numbers, you can. It will throw them down with the chart numbers exception, which is not underneath, but it's chart.
Okay, so you can. Right. Yeah.
But you cannot remove chart numbers.
But you're custom.
All right, okay. So you're getting done. Let's just go and get it done. Concurrent modification exception. We just said, all of us, that it should happen. They have other buffers for by now. Good job. How about arrange the out of bounds exception? Okay, now this is the safest bet.
Both is good. It's like a runtime exception, the non-pointer exception.
Non-pointer exception can always happen. Any takers? Yeah. How about you can remove Chuck Norris from a collection? Guys, you are absolutely crazy. Trust me, you cannot remove Chuck Norris from a collection. But I'll wonder if something interesting. And we actually managed to beat Chuck Norris.
Java 8, 1 point, Chuck Norris, 0.
Now, how the hell we ended up with, of all things, not one exception? Good question. Look here. Erase as least. Which type generates?
Oh, you got a null in there.
No. Where is null? No.
Okay.
Classic array, exactly.
It's a classic array, right?
Exactly, it's a classic array. And in classic array, when you remove an element, you get a null instead.
Yeah, true.
So, the way it works, for each, it's called, it creates, in the bytecode, it creates a new object from a new cluster. It's called splitterator. Splitterator is just a fancy iterator, but it works the same way. And then you call for each remain with the lambda that you pass. Now, for each remain, check for concurrent modification in the end of the loop. It does what it should do, what you wrote there. And then in the end of the loop, not on the loop, in the end of the path inside the loop, mm-hmm. in the end of the iteration, it compares the original size of the list with the current size of the list. If they are different, what happens? Concurrent modification exception, right? This is what we want. Now, why it didn't work here? Because it never got there. Removing the element adds null to the end of the array, obviously, right? Now, on the last iteration, if null equals check, fails with null pointer exception, before it has the chance to compare the size of the array. It marks the size of the array as different, but they won't replace the array because you might want to remove other elements, add elements instead. It doesn't make sense to stop. There is no shrink of the array, right? Array is immutable. The size that it reports is minus one. The array inside is the same. Okay. Now, splitterator got the reference to its array knowing that the size is 3. And it will actually get to 3 because the array is still 3. It will report size 2, but we know that it's 3 there, and it will fail on all but the exception of the last element. Remove if actually works, and it returns lambda, and then it works.
And as many questions on interview, can you scroll back? You should never do like this because this is kind of stuff that should, you know, you should feel it when you see something like this. It's going to be null pointer exception. So chuck dot equals
x.
This is the right thing to do always.
Yeah. By the way, chuck dot equals x. What got the
concurrent
exception that we and chuck would expect.
So this is kind of like even a Java 8 puzzler, but this
trick. This is classic. Right.
Classic.
Right. All right. So by now, you all and Chuck should feel something about that about Java 8. The projector is not very good, but you got the idea.
Yeah.
And
everything is on fire. All
right. That will be the last one.
Yeah.
I guess, right?
Yeah.
Because you're tired. Well, we can go. We have another season that we can still go.
We still expecting people coming from some old game or whatever.
Yeah, no, I don't know, but I expect the brains explode here. And
yeah, let's.
And the maintenance of the resort, they won't be happy on the blood stains and the stuff. Let's not do that.
Yeah, let's finish with something nice. Okay,
this
so
is very nice.
Yeah, this is very nice. So you in this session you learned about optional. Now
you learn to love optional
because it prevents you from null pointer exception. Now, in this particular case, we have two optionals, and we want to see, or I want to ask you and you, like how this is going to behave. So, in the first version, we take the optional off, and after that, you know, if it's nothing there, we're just asking what basically these two lines will print.
RTFM null pointer exception. Null pointer exception, null pointer exception, and null pointer exception, okay?
Yeah. We covered all keys.
Now, if you ask me, first line is trivial, right? Optional of RTFM, it's not null, or else get, I don't care, it's not null, this one happened,
exception.
Of course.
Because
optional.
Optional.
This is what it does.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
My
role is
A. Who fixes A? Who fixes okay, two people?
It's or else, both of and or else return object. No, it's the return, it's the two string of the return of method, of or else.
Yeah.
And the return of that one is the object that we wrapped in optional, in this case, artifact, and in this case, empty, whatever map, empty optional that we tried to. So,
A.
Optional successfully prevented the null pointer. I don't know why you don't believe in that.
How
is there any possible reason in the world not believe in that? How about B? First line work, the second fails. How about C? Optional means null pointer reception for you now. I got it. Good job, sir. Good job, brother. How about null pointer reception at the FM? Yeah, okay. All right. And the correct answer?
Correct answer.
B! Yay! Right.
You were trying to lead us astray.
Yes, I did.
Yeah.
No question.
Look what I have prevented!
I have what?
It's video.
Yeah, it's a video.
Everything's on fire. Okay.
Everything
so explanation is actually pretty simple. Three, dose. Okay, so you can't switch another.
Well, wait a second. Anyone have any idea why the second actually
Oh, yeah,
failed?
Of course, of course.
I'm a 1.4 guy, man.
So, first of all, why or else works? Or else works just because it works as expected. Right? If it's then value, it will be returned. Otherwise, it will be other.
So, the basically, it doesn't go.
Yeah, this one
order.
Is not executed at all, at least
yeah.
Now. We don't deal with it because our dependent just function.
Now, this
second line is a lot of fun. Map of null actually grows null pointer exception if the mapping function is null.
So the off returns optional, you walk map on the optional, and you pass in null.
And
so
boom!
Null pointer exception.
So it didn't, optional didn't protect us just because it failed in some completely different area. It has nothing to do with optional, actually. Right? It's not that bad, it just wasn't there for us.
Yeah, the problem is, I guess it's problem in some inconsistency in different behavior in different places, and that's why we saw no such method exception, null pointer exception, all sorts of stuff. So always consider, you know, check with documentation what's the good, the particular behavior of the certain. Because, like Parv said multiple times, compiler is getting smarter, trying to predict something or, you know, apply something that it is not, because it's just simply maybe it fits a contract, but
right.
Semantically it doesn't.
No, this one was really trivial. If you knew the signature of the map method, you would know that it's thrown out.
Yeah.
There is nothing you can do
without knowing
except
actually.
Of relying on the documentation.
Exactly.
The good news are, you see this yellow right here? This is a screenshot from our favorite IDE IntelliJ IDEA that screams on you right here, you will get null pointer exception.
That's the idea.
That's the idea. Thank you very much for this fun. All right, now you guys should get some sleep now, I guess. And with those conclusions, we will send you away.
Yeah, and you
and the conclusions are?
Yeah.
By the way, did you notice the coincidence that we have right here? With great software comes great responsibility. We need to replace that with that. And this is actually true. Like Java 8 is a piece of art. It has its own problems, of course, but it's a great leap forward for Java that brings much more more power. As it brings more power, it brings more responsibility. And that means that now this responsibility is on you to write a readable code. Don't switch maps in the way we did in production code. Don't.
Or do not write the static implementation of interfaces of the same class.
Right? So, yeah, don't do that. Another, don't do intersection types inside private methods. Don't do that.
Okay.
Well, sometimes it's so good.
Yeah.
Sometimes you really want to switch those maps because this is so awesome.
Yeah, so this is what I wanted to say. Like, if you want to switch them, it looks very nice. You don't need to iterate or create an additional place where you can store something.
It is nice.
Just simply write the code.
This switches the maps. Good luck, debugging.
We actually have another point here. Speaking about good for debugging.
Yeah, no, that's that. So, not this one?
Yeah, not this one. Yeah,
well, sometimes it is a bug you saw one and it was just there for showing you sometimes the bug. Now, we have to confess, I think most of us, that we see more bugs in Java 8 than any previous release of Java.
Which is okay.
Which?
This is what happens with software these days.
And so it's generally a huge leap forward, right, for Java. It's big change, and you know, software breaks. And if you remember the history of the release of Java, how painful it was, how long it took, it was during the transition from Sun to Oracle, there are a lot of good excuses for having bugs. So there are some bugs. Now this is the most single most important outcome of today.
Or yeah, use right tools. Speaking about like a good luck with debugging, IntelliJ allows you to debug in lambdas. You can set into lambdas, and you know, you can see stuff. So
let us put it very simple for you.
Yeah.
If we did this stuff with screenshots
or live coding,
from IntelliJ instead of code written in PowerPoint, there was, you know how many buffers?
Zero.
Everything is analyzed, highlighted, and marked by IntelliJ for you. So for example, when you try to use the max instead of comparator max, it would go ballistic on you. What the hell are you doing? That's not the same, right? This kind of stuff.
And the cool thing, the guy who actually contributed this, contributed this stuff,
right.
He is working on IntelliJ.
Yeah, yeah. He finds these bugs and then he adds those warnings for you inside IntelliJ.
Yeah.
How cool is that?
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Right. So, yeah. IntelliJ does not replace your mail, right? And you still need to read it. And again, Java 8 is a big change. It's a lot of reading, right?
Yeah.
There are great resources, and another friend of ours who works in Zero Turnaround contributes to Zero Turnaround Labs. Rebel Labs. Did you hear about Rebel Labs?
Yes.
Yeah, there is a company, Zero Turnaround, they do great software. Except for great software, they write great like technical blog. And they did a very large series of very thorough blog posts about Java 8, even before it was released. Great resource to get started with Java 8. Articles on lambdas, on strings, on optionals, on everything that you want to know, all of them are there in relatively simple English, as simple as it can get when you talk about this stuff.
And the thing is, it's 2017, to make yourself a present and finally learn something, because it's new exciting stuff. It totally changes the way you program, totally changes the way how you think, and makes your code more concise, and it's like writing in brand new language. And Java 9 is almost done, hopefully.
Yeah, it's nice. Now, the favorite puzzle of mine is the puzzle with the three ways to do the max magic, the one with the keys. And that's because it shows perfectly how you shouldn't abuse lambdas and streams when you don't need them, right? If you remember, the simplest solution, collections.max, the method which is with us for 20 years already, works the most in the most predictable and normal way. So when you don't need streams and lambdas, just don't go.
Yeah, and even though, like, because Bart just mentioned, the Java for us has been here for a very long period of time. So there might be some of the things that are not very concise or not very consistent for persistent in behavior. So,
right. So we have a lot of pathers to tell you about. Java 9 is coming. There will be a whole new world of pathers in Java 9. Now, if you encounter some interesting pattern, please send it to us. We send prizes, t-shirts, stuff to contribute, and of course, we will mention you as a contributor. If you have something, go ahead and send it to pathers@jfrog.com. If you liked it, you put the green thingy into the box. Thank you very much, you already did that. Praise us on Twitter, like, seriously, and in the feedback form that I will, that Codemash is sending, hashtag JavaPuzzlesMG.
Also, you can tweet your puzzlers if it's tweetable.
No, because everybody will see. Not good. Not good. To the email.
Okay.
This is Victor Gamma.
This is Barbara Sadegurski.
And this is the show notes with explanations, pointers to this Rebel Labs blog and some documentation around it. Both slides and video. Slides are already there, video will be there tomorrow. And if you didn't like it, your feedback is very important for us as well.
All right, thank you for guys that you stayed for this late night session.
Thank you.
Thank you.